My name is Chad. I'm lead pastor here at Richwoods Christian Church. I'm truly honored that you're here to celebrate the greatest event in human history. It's not close, and it doesn't matter what we believe about it. Friday was good. Friday was rich. Friday, we looked at the cross and stood in awe, bowed in awe of all that Jesus did when he hung on that rugged tree for our sin to have a relationship with us. But make no mistake about the event that we celebrate today. Make no mistake about it. If we don't have today, Friday is meaningless. Billy Graham said, without the resurrection, the cross is meaningless. This guy named Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament of our Holy Scriptures, said it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He said, and if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless. So if we don't believe that Christ has been raised, then everything I'm about to say, everything that everybody across the world is about to say, is completely useless without the resurrection. He said, and not only that, your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. But in fact. Christ has been raised. And because Jesus has, in fact, a historical witnessed by many, 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 and millions throughout history have testified to its truth. And because Christ has been raised, everyone in this room or joining us online has access to some amazing things. Because Christ has been raised, we have access to forgiveness. Because Christ has been raised, we have access to freedom from our sin, because we have access through guidance from the Holy Spirit of God, because Christ has been raised from the dead, we have access to resurrection power. You see, the resurrection of Jesus is more than just about salvation. We often look at the resurrection and we're like, man, that's it. That's what gave us the ability to pray a prayer and become Christians, or to take on a name, or to be free from sin, or to gain eternity in heaven. But it's so much more than that. Because of the resurrection, we have access to something amazing that's called apprenticeship. It's called fellowship. It's called discipleship. We have the unique Christian invitation to be with Jesus, to become like Jesus, and to do the Jesus stuff. You know what we're doing this morning by gathering together on 8115 North Knoxville? We're doing the Jesus stuff. We're doing the worship stuff. We're going to do some communion stuff. We're going to do some Word of God stuff. We're going to do some fellowship stuff. That is all because of the resurrection. And that is our focus this morning. The cross of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus are more than just good news about our sin. And that is good news, that if you walked in this morning fully stuck in your sin, the resurrection of Jesus Christ gives you the power to live free of that sin, to have that sin paid for and gain eternity forever. But it is more than that. The resurrection and the fact that it happened gives you the power to be a follower of Jesus. See, there are good news inside the resurrection is that we can follow. Our host passage talks about a group of people who had this testimony in Revelation chapter 14, verse 4. It says of this group of people, it is these who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. And that is the power of the resurrection. The power of the resurrection allows common men and women, and that's who we are, right? We're common men and women, right? We have unique skill sets, abilities, talents, but for the most part, we're pretty common, right? We do live in Peoria. Central Illinois, we even use a common word to go with it. Central means middle, nowhere, kind of could find it, kind of could not, right? We're just common folk, right? We're just common folk. But What Jesus called us to be is to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. This word follow is a powerful word. It means to go after or obey. And there are two major parts to being a follower in the New Testament according to Jesus. The first one is this. There is an act of following Jesus literally wherever he goes. To be a follower is to attach yourself to someone and follow them wherever they go. If you have really little ones, you know what this is like, right, mamas? You don't go to the bathroom without the little one, right? Or if you have a dog named Gary, like we do, you don't go to the bathroom without Gary, right? They follow you wherever they go. And that's the first part. The second part is just as important. Because if you're going to follow someone wherever they go, you're going to have to leave behind anything that prevents or hinders this type of fellowship or apprenticeship. Now, in our culture, we are pretty okay with the first one. We're pretty okay with, I understand that if I'm going to follow someone, I'm going to need to go where they go. Often the hindrance or the problem between choosing to follow Jesus and just going to church is we have to leave everything behind that gets in the way. And for us as Americans, that's where it gets tough. Because you know what? We have a lot to lose, a lot to leave behind. Jesus said it this way when he talked about fellowship in Matthew chapter 10. He said, if you love your father or mother more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. Strong words. But Jesus, in his economy, fellowship meant everything. Following him meant leaving everything. He said, or if you love your son or daughter more than me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you're going to lose it. But if you will make the choice, even this morning, to give up your life, you actually will find it. Tim Conway said, if following Christ has never cost you anything, you are not following him. Because fellowship cost us something. Coming to church this morning probably didn't cost you anything. A few bucks of gas. We gave you the coffee for free. If you got here early enough, we gave you free entertainment with fire alarms. You're welcome. You didn't get here early enough, you have no idea what I'm talking about. You missed the show. Fellowship always costs you something. A.W. Tozer said this, if I am to wholly follow the Lord Jesus Christ, I must forsake everything that is contrary to him. And this is what the resurrection gave us the ability to do. It gave us the power we need to choose to forsake everything and anything that is contrary to him. And what Jesus wanted when he rose from the dead was not people just to come to church, not people just to consider him occasionally when life gets hard, but to take anything that is contrary to him and give that up to follow him wherever he goes. In Matthew 19, 21, Jesus said this. He said, Jesus told him, if you want to be perfect, go and sell all your possessions. He was talking to a guy who had a lot of possessions. Very American issue, right? We have a lot of possessions. The poorest person in this room is richer than most of the world. It's a fact. He's talking to this rich guy and he says, if you want to be perfect, you want everything I'm offering, go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor and you will have treasure in heaven. Then, don't stop there, come and follow me. Today I'm going to ask you three Easter questions to ponder. And the first one is this. What is hindering you from following Jesus? What is hindering you from following Jesus? And maybe you didn't come this morning expecting to be asked questions. You didn't know there was going to be a quiz. You also didn't know there was going to be a fire alarm. Welcome to Richwoods. It's what we do. We do quizzes on Easter. It's fun. And here's the first question. What is hindering you from following Jesus? Going to church, no problem. Tapping in occasionally, no problem. But the power of the resurrection, the invitation of the resurrection was that you would follow Jesus. And for all of us, there is something on the list that is getting in the way of hindering Jesus. You may be the thing getting in the way. A relationship may be the thing getting in the way. A choice or something you don't want to let go of yet may be getting in the way. What is it? Even if you're not ready to give up that thing and follow Jesus, maybe this morning you could just at least identify that thing so that you could stand before God and say, you know what, God? I at least have identified what is keeping me from all-out apprenticeship to Jesus. Because let me tell you the heart of God this morning. He longs for you to follow him. He's so glad you're here. He designed it that you would be here. He willed you to be here. But it is his heart that you would follow him wherever he goes. He would love to look behind him and see you walking in his dust. Jesus also had this to say about following him in Matthew chapter 4. And one day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, also called Peter, and Andrew, throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. Jesus called out to them, said, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of people. I will show you how to fish for people." And look what they did. They left their nets at once and followed him. Jesus considered following him a twofold action. First, it was leaving the old behind. And second, was embracing a new purpose for your life. This is what it means to follow Jesus. It means to leave and cleave to Jesus. This is the way marriage works, right? A good marriage. If you try to stay with mom and dad and cleave to your husband or wife, eventually, fellas, she's gonna say, "You gotta cut the cord, homeboy. Living in the basement's nice and free. We gotta go. Your mom's driving me nuts," right? Like, you got to leave and you got to cleave. And Jesus is offering the same thing to these boys who are fishing. You need to leave those nets so I can give you new nets, because we're gonna fish for people now. See, that's what it means to follow. Bob Goff said this, I love it. People who follow Jesus are no longer typical. Amen? Amen. Bunch of weirdos in here. I've been longing to tell 400 people they're weird, and I just got to do it. We're no longer typical. God is constantly inviting us into a life that moves away from typical. That's what it means to follow. These boys were fishing. There were probably other fishing boats around them. Jesus said, "Yo, come with me. I'll show you how to fish for men." They left their nets, and everybody must have been looking at them thinking, "What are Peter and Andrew doing?" They chose a life that was not typical, right? Russell Nelson said, "When we follow Jesus Christ, we act as he would act and love as he would love." It's not just that we go to church. If you're new to church, maybe it's your first time all year. Maybe this is your 100th time all year. I don't even know if it's that many. There's not even that many Sundays yet. This year, you know, whatever, 12th time. This is just what we do. This is normal. This isn't no longer typical. It's how we follow out there that is no longer typical. And that's what he longs for. He assumed we would do this, but he's calling us to fellowship. The Apostle Paul, one of the most faithful apprentices of Jesus in history, describes it this way in Ephesians chapter 5. He says, "Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love." You know, that should be a description of us who are followers of Jesus, apprentices of Jesus, that we should be described as people of love. Following the example of Christ, he loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Easter question number 2, where could you begin imitating God? Because here's what's awesome. The resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us the power to look and talk and act and be like Jesus, not just on Sunday. You and I have the ability to imitate God, to look like him, to, when people come into our aura, they're reminded of God, not religious people. They're reminded of Jesus. When they hang out with us, they're like, wow, I wonder if Jesus was that loving. And we can remind them, he's who we got it from. Because we don't just love those who love us. We love our worst enemy. That's what it means to imitate God. Jesus washed the feet of the guy who betrayed him. He ate dinner with him. He invited him to be an apprentice. And that apprentice named Judas listened to him for 3.5 years. And Jesus knew the whole time, he's the one that's going to hand me over to be crucified. But that's the Jesus way. That's what we're invited to today. Not just to know about the power of the resurrection, but to ask ourselves, where could I begin to imitate God? Jesus was also clear about what following him would look like. Man, when people are following Jesus, what does it look like? Here's what Jesus said in John chapter 8. Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, Jesus didn't assume we would. He knew that'd be a choice. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Let me share this with you quick and don't miss this point. People who attend church often still walk in darkness and confusion throughout their lives. Often. Just because we go to a church, whether this is your home church or not, maybe you're here from out of town, just because you go to church, you attend a worship service, does not mean that a lot of your life is still walking in confusion and darkness. But that's the difference for followers. You see, apprentices of Jesus, followers of Jesus, disciples of Jesus, walk in the light and the dust of their rabbi. John chapter 10, verse 27, my sheep, Jesus said, listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. See, the thing about apprenticeship is we don't have to question where we're going. We can. We're like, man, Jesus, where is this going, right? Pandemic hit in 2020. Me and my wife were like, oh, I don't think God wants us in Las Vegas anymore. I wonder where he wants us. And he didn't tell us for a while because he knew if I tell you Peoria, Illinois, you're going to run away like Jonah. So he waited and he waited and he waited. And then we came and visited and my wife's like, I love it. And I'm like, are you sure? Okay, Jesus. But no point through that whole thing were we confused or in darkness. We were just waiting for God to light the lamp of our feet because we knew we were following him and wherever he went was where we wanted to be. And that's the difference between going to church, knowing about the resurrection, celebrating it once a year, and having the resurrection power to follow him wherever he goes. Francis Chan said this, the world says, love yourself. Grab all you can. Follow your heart. We may be hearing this message louder now than ever in the history of our country. This is the new religion. Love yourself. Grab all you can. And follow your heart. You get into the scripture and you find out, my heart is desperately wicked. My heart is deceitful. My heart is selfish. My heart makes choices only on its own. So how do I follow something that has like no concern for anybody else? That's why Jesus comes and Jesus says, deny yourself. Grab your cross and follow me. Amen. And that's the invitation of the resurrection. Galatians chapter 5, verse 25, Paul said, this is what it looks like. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Is this describe your life right now? Do you have a constant guide through life? Man, there's no other peace like the peace that comes from the person of Jesus when we can say, God, I'm following you. Where are you going? What you doing? What's crazy? I was asking it just like 45 minutes ago. I'm standing out in the common. Sirens are blaring. I have no idea. I think Tom's playing a practical joke on us. I don't know what's going on, right? But I'm like, Jesus, you got it. We'll do the service with the fire alarms. We'll do it. Whatever. There's probably worse worship in town. We'll do it. We'll make it happen. But you just follow the Spirit's lead with every part of your life. Francis Chan said this, following Jesus is not. Don't miss this. If you grew up in a religious system and religiosity has done damage to you, or you've been told to follow rules, or you grew up in a legalistic system of church, following Jesus is not about diligently keeping a set of rules or conjuring up the moral fortitude to live good lives. That is religion. That is outside in following God. That is outside in. That is man's attempt to control God. Here's what fellowship is about. It's about loving God and enjoying Him. Amen. Let me ask you, are you enjoying Jesus? Are you enjoying Jesus? Man, I sat there while Brian was thundering away about the names of God, and I thought, this is the best life ever. Like, there's people still sleeping right now. Lame. This is awesome. Are you kidding me? It's so good. So let me ask you another Easter question, the last one. We know Jesus rose from the dead. Maybe many of you have accepted that fact and you're a believer, you're a churchgoer. How could you start loving and enjoying God? Instead of just doing all the things, instead of keeping all the rules, what if God brought you here this morning to remember that I can be an apprentice? I can follow Him wherever He goes. I can imitate God with my life. I can love and enjoy God despite the circumstances, despite the storm, despite the election in November, despite how our economy is, despite the taxes in Illinois, despite how much gas costs. It is all irrelevant to the people of love who are apprenticing under Jesus, because we have the power of the resurrection living inside us, and we can choose to love and enjoy God at any time. So here's my question. Why not start right now? When you walked in, hopefully you got a communion cup. If you didn't, I'm sure we can get you some, or you can walk out there and grab one real quick, and we're going to take communion together. You know what this is all about? Communion is all about loving and enjoying God. It's about remembering what Jesus did. That's why there's a little piece of bread on the top. We remember His body that hung on the cross, that died for us. We remember His blood that was perfection and wiped away all of our sin. We can even pause this morning and remember His resurrection that gave us the ability to do what? Love and enjoy God. But for some of us in this room, we're going to have to ask ourselves, what is preventing me from pausing right now and giving my life into the hands of Jesus and following Him when I leave this room? What is keeping me from following Jesus when I leave this room? You went to church on Easter. Check. But what's it matter when you walk out those doors? Let me promise you, the resurrection of the God-man was more than about getting 60 minutes of your life. His deepest desire is that you would pause, remember Him, and follow Him in apprenticeship to Jesus. What is preventing you from putting your hands in the hands of God? I want us to use this time of communion to connect, speak with God, who rose from death so you and I could have relationship with Him today. As we pause and remember the body, remember the blood, what's the prayer you need to pray to the resurrected Savior this morning? Only you know that. And it's different all across the room. But it's why we're here. We are here this morning, not just to celebrate, not just to remember the resurrection, not to just celebrate its power, not just to do the thing before the lunch thing with the family. God brought you here to Richwoods Christian Church because He wants 400 plus people and their children to follow Him with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that is the invitation that I believe God wanted me to invite you to this morning. Let me pray for us, and then we'll take communion, and we'll raise this roof one more time. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can have a relationship with you. Thank you that your resurrection made the cross worth it, made the cross make sense, made the cross not the end. Your resurrection was power. Your resurrection showed this is Yeshua, this is Messiah, this is Jesus, the one you waited for. And you did all that, endured all that, suffered all that, rose, went back to your Father, so that the people, us, could choose to believe the good news of the death and resurrection of Jesus and choose to follow you wherever you go. I pray that at Richwoods Christian Church this morning, we just didn't have Easter service. We just didn't celebrate the resurrection. But to today, this morning, at 8:30 in the morning, God, there are people choosing, maybe for the first time, maybe choosing again, that they will wholly follow you wherever you go. That they will begin to imitate you. They will begin to be intimate with you. They will serve you with their heart, their soul, mind, and strength. I pray that all over the room there are people once again falling in love with who you are. As we take communion, Lord, I pray there's a beautiful time of talking and being with you. In Jesus' name.